an agenda which was placed at the door entryway. We are deviating again a little bit from norm, as we have done in our last two board workshops. Generally, we have hearing of school district patrons at the beginning of the meeting, and throughout the meeting, there is no interaction with the patrons as far as conversation with the board. But because we had a building utilization committee that involved many of you that are in the audience right now, we have found it necessary to direct different questions to those individuals that served on that committee. So we will continue that process tonight, calling upon members of the building utilization to speak or to be addressed. You will be, if those individuals wish to say something, please raise your hand and you will be identified by me and asked to proceed. This will just help us. We did, for those of you that are not familiar with what the building utilization committee was all about, is approximately 60 different community members that met over about a 5 or 8 time meeting. It was very much involved. And again, on behalf of the entire board, I'd just like to thank you for being a part of that. It was very helpful. You gave us much insight into the decisions that's before our district right now. And so as we work through things, we may say, someone from building utilization, could you please enhance us? Because we did break up into groups, and we are all not privy of what happened in each of the different groups. So that's the purpose of deviating from our norm, and that's the purpose of having this set up the way we are tonight, just so that we can feel as though we're more a part of the whole. So again, welcome. Let the minutes reflect that our secretary has arrived. Okay. And the next item is hearing of school district patrons. I would like the secretary please to read the guidelines.
Sorry for being late. Addressing the board. If you wish to address the board during a Board of Education meeting, please note the following guidelines. Individuals may speak to the board during the hearing of district patrons. Each speaker needs to identify him or herself by name or address. Speakers need to limit their comments to 5 minutes. If the speaker represents an organization or group, he or she should indicate whether the comments represent the official view of the organization or are his or her personal comments. If a delegation is present to address the board, the delegation may be asked to select up to 5 representatives to speak on its behalf for a total of not more than 15 minutes. Written statements should be given to the board secretary and are considered public documents. If you wish to state a complaint against a board member, an employee, or a student, an initial allegation is permitted. Thereafter, the affected individual may request that further discussion takes place in a closed session pursuant to the Open Meetings Act. In general, issues brought to the board's attention will be referred to the superintendent for investigation and study, and a response will be provided at a later date. These guidelines are based on the procedural regulations of Lance Creuse Public Schools Policy 1370, Public Participation.
Thank you. We received one request.
Sarah Kirby.
Yes, please. That way the mic will amplify your voice.
My name is Sarah Kirby. I live at 27267 Park Circle in Chesterfield Township. I want to thank the school board and administration for the opportunity I had to serve on the school building utilization committee. On this committee, parents and educators were brought together to explore how the district can best use its facilities. With the declining enrollment and decrease in state funding, this was a very difficult task. Over the course of 5 months, we looked at the capacity and layout of our schools, the cost of educating our students, and programs we would like to see offered in Lance Creuse. I feel the proposals that we presented to the board in January would benefit the district in the long term. The administration tweaked our ideas and came up with a plan that has some exciting opportunities for our students. I would like to address the proposal of international students and why I support this particular item. I was able to spend the summer of my junior year in Denmark, which was a life-changing experience. I learned that though the language, customs, and foods were different, our goals, love for family, and desire to be understood were the same. Getting to know people from other cultures makes the world seem more accessible. It enlarges perspective, and it's a lot of fun, too. My son Caleb graduated from high school north last year. In September, he left for a missionary training center, and in October, he arrived in Mexico, where he will be until the fall of 2016. His high school Spanish helped prepare him for this experience, and now he is fluent in the language and interacts easily with the people of Mexico City. Opportunities can take our students anywhere in the world. Why not bring some of the world to them now? We have hosted international students three times, one being through Lance Creuse, and we have loved learning about other cultures right in our home. Inviting international students does have a financial benefit to both the district and the community. These kids do an awful lot of shopping. They can also make a tremendous impact on those they interact with. International students tend to be studious, hardworking, and have a sense of adventure. They are willing to try new things and encourage those around them to do the same. The only thing I would ask is that the effort is made to help the community get to know these students so we can interact with each other. I hope you'll give this program a try.
Thank you. We have no other cards, but is there anyone who wishes to address the board at this time? Hearing or seeing none, we'll proceed. The next item on the agenda is discussion on building utilization materials, and I'm going to hand this over to our superintendent, Ms. Johnson.
Okay, thank you. Well, the first thing I did want to do was just talk a little bit about the process that got us here today, although there have been a few things that have said that have talked about that. Because building utilization actually began with the Strategic Planning Committee, a different group of 60 stakeholders. One of the items that they brought forward was the need to look at building utilization. So from that strategic planning perspective, the Building Utilization Committee was formed this year, as discussed. This committee toured buildings, they immersed themselves in data week after week after week after week. That information was put onto the website so that our entire public could see what the Building Utilization Committee was looking at, and updates were provided as they came about, as well as brief updates in our board meeting. And this culminated with, again, it was touched on a couple minutes ago, with the Building Utilization Committee creating a recommendation that was presented to the board on January 26th. And what was really good about this, well, there was a lot of really good things about the recommendations, but what it did is it gave room for administration to go back and talk to some of the instructional experts about how we would do some of these things. So if there's advanced programming, what would some of the instructional experts recommend? So the Building Utilization Committee really gave us the what it was that they wanted us to do and kind of left the how up to administration. So administration came back to the board on February 18th to talk through what some of those options could look like. So for example, if you're going to talk about advanced programming, that can look a lot of different ways. It can be programs in specific buildings, it can be embedded into all of our buildings, it can be pull out, it can be push in. So we had conversations about what that might look like to get feedback from the board. Administration then went back, did some additional work, again using the support of a lot of the experts, and came back to you with a recommendation just last week on March 18th. The board, we did spend quite a bit of time talking about repurposing an elementary school, which was one of the recommendations that came forward at the last meeting, and the board appropriately said, we need more time and we need more data. And from that, here we are today, with an opportunity of more time and some additional data, which Michelle is going to talk about in a couple of minutes. She's going to start to review that data with us. But before we get started on reviewing the data, I just want to take 1 minute to make sure that everyone knows that each of us understands that when we're talking about this, the data really is our children, you know, our students, our community, and our staff. So when we're up here talking about numbers, and we're going to talk about numbers a little bit here this evening, I know, and everyone sitting at this table, these tables know, that we're talking about our kids and our families and our staff, and that you guys have built really strong relationships, that you support each other, and that you consider your buildings your families. And we know that. But we also know that if we're going to have a conversation potentially about repurposing a building, that it's also important that we look at objective data, and we do look at some data. And so while we're going to talk about the data a little bit, because we need that objective information, we don't for a minute forget that what it really is the people here. And we have 10 elementary schools, and the staff in our 10 elementary schools are exceptional, all 10 elementary schools. They are committed to the success of every student. Our parents in all 10 of our elementary schools care about their kids, want the best education possible for their kids, and are true partners. And the kids in every one of our 10 elementary schools are phenomenal. We have great kids in all 10 of our elementary schools. So this is not about a problem with our elementary schools. This is a discussion about declining enrollment and financial challenges and how we best utilize our dollars to make sure that we keep the money as close to the programs that benefit kids. And so really figuring out how to maximize our dollars. Making sure always, always, always that we're first taking care of our kids. That's our number one priority. In the proposal that was presented, or the additional data that was presented, there was a draft timeline that was provided to you. And that draft timeline, which will require much more detail as we go along, is based on an idea that the board would come to a conclusion to repurpose a building today, which may or may not happen. That will be, of course, up to the board. I would, before any discussions continue, like to provide an alternate option, and actually an option I like better, but not without, you know, some challenges. And that option would be, if the board determines that they are interested in repurposing an elementary school, which is our recommendation, was presented to you at our last meeting and continues to be our recommendation today. But if the board is interested in proceeding with that, the recommendation I might make on a timeline would be for the board to approve the repurposing of a school this evening, but not to get into the detail of what school, and instead schedule a meeting for next Tuesday or Wednesday to complete that discussion. And what that would do is that would allow us an opportunity to have a public forum so that anyone who chooses to comment on this issue could be invited to do so. That all call to our community to provide that opportunity hasn't occurred because we haven't been in a place yet that indicates that that's appropriate, that we know that that's, you know, necessary. So that's why I'm saying if the board gets to a point this evening where you want to take action, or believe you should, no, I don't know that anyone wants to, but believe you should take action to repurpose a building, you certainly could identify the building tonight. Or another option, again, as I mentioned, is to schedule a meeting next week, Tuesday or Wednesday, and allow us Monday or Tuesday, whatever day that is, in advance of the board meeting, to have a public forum where people could come and voice their concerns. It would, the challenge that I referenced when I said that there was a suggestion, the challenge is we would have to clear our calendars. we all know how difficult it is to get this whole group in the room. In fact, sometimes it takes over a month for us to get together, so that is not without its challenges, but we were able to do it this week, so I was optimistic. So again, I just wanted to put that idea out on the table. Certainly, the conversation has to go quite a ways before we're ready to get to that. So if it's appropriate, I'd like to ask Rochelle to just go through the documents that have been sent to you.
Can I interrupt just for a minute? Did you mention there is a timeline? You said there was a timeline provided?
Yes.
Where is it?
It was emailed to today on the...
Yesterday.
Yesterday, so it was emailed on the link to...
I have a copy.
Yeah.
Pam, do you want to look at it?
Yeah. I'd like one too.
It was, yeah, so what we did is we did email and then we posted it, you know, yes, 24 hours later on Edge Portal, because at that time Edge Portal was open to the community, so we wanted to give you an opportunity to see it first.
Okay, Rochelle.
Thank you. So the first document, this is a last week when we had a meeting, there was, as Jackie mentioned, a request for more information. So this first chart shows available capacity, and as a reminder, we did capacity based on 28 seats per a classroom. So it may not be, that's not necessarily the average, but that's how we went ahead and did it. So what this capacity chart shows is if we were to repurpose a particular school, what's the impact on the remaining four schools? We did this based on the north end and this is the south end. So the north end, for example, we have capacity in the second column. So you can see our total capacity on the north end is 3,024 seats. Our projected enrollment for next year is 2372, which means we have 652 available seats. So if we were to take Atwood, and let's say we decide to repurpose Atwood, that means we would have to take their children and absorb those students in the remaining four elementaries. So based on that, there is not enough capacity on the north end to absorb those in Atwood if we were to choose it. And that's what we did with every single one. So for example, in Carver North, we are 48 seats would be short. Chesterfield, we have excess capacity of 148 seats. Green is 36, and then Higgins is 120 seats. Now, what we also did is we kept the specials. If you recall, we talked about this last week, specials, the music and we're in the Spanish room. We kept those online. We didn't have those in our capacity number, but we certainly, because we counted full-size classrooms. So what we did is on the bottom, so if we were looking at Atwood, we would have, we're short 20, but there's 8 available other rooms within the other 4 elementaries that we could certainly utilize. Now, this may require music being on a cart or Spanish being on a cart, but we could do it if necessary. And for the remaining of, 4 schools on the north end, we have 7 extra available rooms.
Is this with or without moving the 66 students that you talked to?
This is including, the 66 kids are in these numbers. I mean, this is projected, this is, so it's not actual count, but the kids are in the projected enrollment.
They are not moved.
They are not moved.
Okay. Have you spoken with these 66 kids already? Or their families?
So we actually did a little bit of work on the 66 students. The 66 students or the number of kids in that community. We took a look at how many were there. Because one of the conversations that came up is this is a neighborhood that has been moved previously, and moving kids a second time is always a concern. So we were able to go back and look at the data on the number of kids who could potentially be moved twice if we did move the 66 students in their elementary school career, and it was less than 10. It's still, you know, it's still obviously a serious issue, but it is, it's a relatively manageable number. We have not talked to any families about this proposal. We are coming to the board first.
But you have 66 kids identified.
Yes, we know, we have two communities that are, that live on the south side of the district, but are being transported to the north side of the district for their education. And in the, and what I think you're referring to is in the proposal last week, we had shown what it would look like if those students who reside in the south side were educated in the south side. It's not included here.
So in this, what you're showing us is that they would be moved to one of the buildings in the north end, those 66 kids.
They're already in the project.
They're already there.
Okay.
They don't get to move.
They used to put them aside.
Is the reason that, that those neighborhoods were looked at because of where they are? Because some of the information that I'm hearing from some of the parents in that neighborhood feel that they might possibly be being targeted because the board or administration might feel like they're the least likely to complain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean, when the, you can certainly, not right this second, obviously, but when the these are kids that live on the south side of the district and are moved, you know, by bus to the north end for their education versus being on the south end where their neighbors are.
Yeah, but they go to school in a school that's their home school. It doesn't matter where they live. They've been transported to a school that's their home school. So thinking it's going to be better for them to be moved to a different school in the south end because someone eight streets over goes to that school doesn't really have any relevance.
Well, the good news is this provides for not moving those students. So if that is where we would like to be, this analysis assumes that those kids stay where they've always been or move with their group of peers if the school that they're in is the one that's selected for.
And also, and I guess my question would be, in looking at, in last week when we were discussing this, I hate to say targeting, but in pulling out those 66 kids, it leads me to believe that there's already been a school that's been identified for being closed.
If we've gone
that far as to look at neighborhoods in which, then you've identified a school in which kids would be moved back.
No, I think yes. That no, that's
because we wouldn't close. We wouldn't just move these 66 kids, but close a different school.
Yeah, and so the reason we did that was we are showing the north end, and we are showing the south end, and you can see how much excess capacity is on each side, 652 seats on the north end and 426 seats on the south end. The purpose of the discussion of the 66 is to say, if we were to choose a north end building to repurpose, but if we desired to have additional available seats, that would be an option on how to achieve that. And that, so it's a north end, south end discussion. It's not specific.
So we're having two different discussions. A discussion of whether or not to move 66 kids from a certain building, and then which building we would target for repurposing.
Not necessarily. They're already, those 66 kids are already counted.
Yeah, take that off the table.
Take that off the table. They're already counted in whatever school they go to. Personally, I don't even know what building they go to.
So,
well, good. You've got information I don't know.
Information.
So, but they're already included in this. And just for the audience explanation, when we talk north and south end, we're talking Hall Road is the dividing line. So it's south or north of Hall Road. I think we had a question or a comment. You were on the organization.
Yes. Rochelle, would you go back to the north end slide just for a moment, please? My question, I guess, is in terms of Higgins. If you're saying that Higgins were the ones to stay open and would absorb other students, if Higgins is going to do that and going to add even one section, a specials room will get lost. And you just said that no specials rooms would get lost. And I, you know, having being the person who I know will be the room that gets lost, I'm not entirely happy about it, but is that a plan? Then you can't say for sure that you know no special rooms will get lost. That's all I'm saying.
I don't recall you saying that.
Yes, you did.
You said you would be able to keep all the specials, Rochelle, I thought she said that all the specials rooms at the North End would stay intact, which if Higgins gains a section, cannot happen. Because we're full.
It's cushioned, so there are cushioned, and it would be, these rooms would be available on the North End, special rooms that could absorb any extra.
So then you cannot say that specials rooms would remain intact, not if we are cushioned. You can't say that.
I think, from what I see, depending on if you close any particular building, there would be a distribution of students across the remaining buildings. I don't think that any one scenario is being looked at. So we're looking at total capacity if you close a building. So that may or may not require students or classrooms being switched, but in the scenarios being given to us, the total capacity could handle the number of students that we have in that area. Whether how it would affect each particular building would be unique depending on what if you were to close a building of a particular size, that impact from that building would have a unique impact on the other buildings in that area.
That's
so,
what I'm saying.
Sure. So I appreciate your, you know, here we're looking at scenarios and people are expressing a lot of concerns. Of course there's concerns. We don't know yet. We have no plan. We have no idea. We're looking at the data to see what the possibilities are. I think from your concern, it is possible to close another building in the North End and still not impact the classrooms you're talking about, just from a sheer number of amount of capacity dependent on which building you might close. If. But we're looking at total capacity and the individual buildings.
I understand what you're saying. I guess I just want to make the point that I don't think we can say for certain that specials rooms will not be touched. I am quite certain that there will be a scenario at some point. Whether it be in Higgins or in Atwood or
whatever
building. So we need to take that into consideration.
Absolutely.
And not only will I no longer be able to use most of the technology that I currently use, because I'm not going to be able to travel rooms and do all that and set it all up, but it's also, you're also talking about moving classroom teachers out of the classrooms, and they will not be able to use their rooms for prep, which is...
We're not there yet.
I think we're getting
I think she's ahead of us because it's disingenuous to say we won't be closing specials rooms if we do this, when in fact, depending on, you can't say it's our classrooms are going to be capped at 28 because you may have more third graders moving to buildings than you do second graders. I mean, it's not, the formula doesn't...
So would you propose we don't have this discussion at all?
No, I would propose that we should have gotten a lot more information a long time ago.
Yeah, let's let Tim...
The room at Higgins that you're referring to, Higgins Elementary has a dedicated computer lab, which many of our buildings do not. So the discussion was that computer lab is a full-size classroom that can be regained as a classroom space, leaving Spanish alone. But it would be taking the computer lab, which not all of our buildings have dedicated computer labs, and moving those computers possibly to the media center.
Okay, so I think we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, so let's get back to our presentation, please.
So at the South End, we did the same philosophy is we have total capacity of 2380 projected enrollment for next year's 1954.
Just a quick question. So this plan takes away all of our computer labs and moves them all to the media centers?
No.
One school.
Only one school?
Only one school has one.
There's one there, there's one at Yax Elementary School also. Yax has a dedicated classroom as, you know, because they've had the luxury, you know, they've had the extra space, so they've moved computers in there.
So two schools have computer labs.
I know Lowe's found this one too. Unless they get rid of it this year, did they?
Tim, I'm sorry. So you can check them out. I'll continue on this track. Available seats is 426. So yeah, if it was grand repurposed, we'd be short 50. Lowest all week, there would be an excess of 6. South River, short 162. Tenniswood, short 22. And then Yax, short 22. And again, the the special rooms below would be, if we needed access to these, are rooms that would be available